Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. My name is Marcela Černochová, and I'm the Managing Director of the British Chamber of Commerce. And I am delighted that I can welcome you on behalf of the Chamber on a discussion called When Business Meets Politics, Dialogue on Lobbying, Ethics, and Accountability. And I'm glad that you have decided to join this discussion, as I strongly believe that this is a very important topic for all of us. Lobbying is relevant to all of us because we all need to defend and enforce our own interests as individuals, communities, businesses, or society. And it is actually an essential part of the democratic decision-making process. And we all are really directly affected by results of lobbying, sometimes in our favor, sometimes not. Unfortunately, in the Czech Republic, the understanding and image of lobbying is rather incorrectly perceived as something very negative, sometimes even as a synonym for corruption and crime. Therefore, I'm really glad that today we can hold this discussion and that we can provide you with relevant information and insight views from two very experienced lobbyists from two countries, Czech Republic and Great Britain. Maybe just one more note. The event will be recorded, so you can come back to it later on and maybe to look and listen to the most interesting part once again, or you can look for some interesting information if you need. So now, please let me welcome and introduce Václav Nekvapil and Stuart Thompson, who agreed to join us for this discussion. And maybe just a short introduction to our great speakers. To introduce Václav Nekvapil. He is the managing partner of the Prague office of CEC Group. His public affairs expertise is especially strong in ICT, financial services, EU affairs, defense, and many, many other areas. But Václav has also plenty of experience working or cooperating with governmental and public institutions. And he has also been very active in a number of organizations and associations. And that includes also the British Chamber of Commerce. Václav recently published a book, which is called We All Are Lobbyists, which is interesting reading. I can certainly recommend this to you, and you will get very good overview about the situation and what the lobbying is. So Václav, many thanks for joining us and welcome.
Thank you.
And now to our second speaker, Stuart Thompson. Let me introduce him. Stuart is the head of public affairs at BDP Pitmans. He is a public affairs and communications specialist, advising clients on all elements of their public affairs strategies. Stuart is also the author of several books. His most recently published and very highly rated book is called Public Affairs, A Global Perspective. So there is another food for your thoughts to read. And what's also interesting is that Stuart won the best current affairs influencer category at Vuelio's Online Influence Awards 2020. So Stuart, welcome, and thank you for agreeing to join this discussion. So as you can see, we have two great experts, and there is something which we can really look forward to learn about the lobbying. Václav, Stuart, the virtual floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Marcela. Thanks for the kind introduction. I will just add that the English version for those who don't speak Czech of the book will follow later this year. So I will work on this very soon. Thank you for this. I mean, nice introduction and for this opportunity. As we work a lot in the chamber on many issues, including transparency, ethics in business relations, and as we are British chamber with British companies mostly present in the company, the idea was to, I mean, put it in a context, in broader context, with a country which has one of the longest democratic tradition in Europe, which has some institutions we don't have, and some institutions which maybe would be needed here. We will speak also about the rules for transparency and lobbying, and I'm very glad that both of you, Stuart and me, are not only doing the job we do, but also try to educate people. And we, my personal experience also from business circles, including the chamber, is that not everyone fully understand what the lobbying or public affairs is about. Not some customers of us or potential customers maybe then don't call it lobbying, but this kind of communication discipline is needed to be explained. And I will just mention one thing: we have in both our countries there are the Association of Professional Lobbyists. I'm president of the Czech one, the Association of Public Affairs Agencies, APPA, and in the UK, Stuart is active in BRCA, right? The British. So we both try to work inside the community to educate and to make people informed what the lobbying and public affairs is. So thank you, and maybe for our audience, we will. The plan is that we have now less than 1.5 hours until 3:30 Central European Time, so 2:30 in the UK, and we will start with the conversation. We have several topics to kick off the discussion with Stuart. And I will open the floor afterwards to anyone. So you can raise your hands, and we can either you can be allowed or make speak. But also, I'm sending into the chat a link for Slido, which is very easy. It's Slido/BritChem, where you can write the questions, comments, and I will try to pick those who will be. Who are relevant, and I will. If you don't want to ask personally, you can put it in Slido, and we will pick them up later in this conversation. So, Stuart, thank you for this. Maybe I will start a little unusually, which usually people end, but I want to start with that. I think as I said, the audience is composed here from business leaders, from various British and Czech companies, but also we have some activists for transparency and others. What do you want to be remembered from this conversation? What do you think is the least known or thing which should be repeated and which you want to put an emphasis on during the next discussion?
Well, thank you for the invite today. It's a pleasure to be involved and to speak to you all today. I mean, I think I could give a really sort of long-winded answer to this, question, but I won't. You'll be glad to know. I think critically, the more that transparency is involved in everything we do, the more that we take the role of ethics seriously. And that's both on the political side and also the sort of the lobbying side of things as well. I think the better. So whilst we all suffer and have suffered from various, they're called lobbying, scandals, and they keep going on. We've just been through a couple here with Boris Johnson receiving text messages from sort of leading business people, but then, more importantly, or maybe a higher profile one with David Cameron now, again, the former Prime Minister here, undertaking sort of lobbying work, but not being captured by, or that work not being captured by the current rules. So I think, everything we say, and I know we've got some discussion points around, you know, how to build relationships and things like that, which, but I would come back to those points. I would come back to the, sort of the rules around what we do, both set by government, sort of statutory legislative side of things, but also those set by the, you know, the associations that we're members of, so the CIPR and the PRCA from my perspective. The more that we can have that, the more that people can have faith in what we do as part of the political system, as a valuable role within the political system, the better. But, you know, frankly, I think a lot of it is up to us to explain as well. So it is around, you know, reputation of ourselves, absolutely, but it is also about telling audiences, the public, but also politicians, what we do as well, and the benefits. So I you know, I think, yeah, everything we talk about here, I'd frame back to those particular points.
Thank you, Stuart. That's so we will come back to a lot of issues you raised in the conversation. I think I will make a short advertisement of a very nice podcast, which Stuart was recently host, and I'm following it from the very beginning. It's one of the very few podcasts on about lobbying, which I mean, shamelessly in the beginning was named The Lobbying Show. For some reason, shamelessly, and now they rename it to Political Life, which I don't know why they changed the title, because maybe they were afraid of the word lobbying. I don't know. But in one of the previous episodes in the US, very US centric. And you were there as one of the few European, or as they say, international guests. there was a guest one last year, John Raffaele, the American lobbyist, who said, which, and I like this abbreviation of like four features of lobbying, which the good lobbyist or anyone who lobbies should master, basically. That lobbying is about policy, politics, processes, and personalities. So four P's. A lot of people think that it's just about personalities. You should know good people. And there, the content doesn't matter, but it's not like that. And we will touch upon the Cameron scandal recently. It's not also a politics, because the political life and the debates in the parliament is one part of it, but there are processes which should be also followed, and of course personalities are also important, that you should know whom you talk to. Out of these four P's, what do you think should be, or how do you see this concept, and would you add something, or what do you think is the most deserves to be most known, or to better understand what lobbying is, Stuart?
Yeah, that's a really tough question, you know, because I think it really depends on what the issue is that you're trying to engage with government or other stakeholders. Well, it really depends on which one you're going to, you know, the nature of the issue. Having said that, I think you're entirely right. We tend often to focus on the P of politics. That's the one that most people instinctively understand. And certainly from you know, my perspective, when I'm dealing with clients, you know, that's the one they have a more natural affiliation for, if you like. They know and understand the politics a little better than maybe the process and the other P's as well. And that's what we bring. We bring an understanding of the other parts of that timetable, I think, if we want to call it that. So we help fill in the blanks there. But I think, you know, today anyway, you know, and that might change tomorrow, but I think I'd go for the policy side of things. And the reason I say that is because I think it helps us to think about the entire sort of timeline of our engagement on issue. So it helps to us to sort of visualize the plan of what we're trying to do. And I think what I'm... I think we've got some feedback there. I think what I mean by that is that, you know, if we're going to be effective in what we do, then the engagement starts early, you know, and we focus on deliverables for deliverable solutions for the stakeholders. So I suppose, you know, my general approach to doing public affairs, again, public affairs, lobbying, government affairs, we get called all sorts of different things. And again, we might come back to that, but we'll get, you know, but it's effectively, it's around government. It's around that political engagement, which is the critical point. But if you start that engagement early, and you can focus on some sort of deliverable outcome, a solution, then both of those points will make your engagement much more effective. So so when you think about your sort of, you know, the system in which we're operating, and trying to put that constructive engagement to you know, to right from the outset, it's about trying to shape the policies of the future, or make the existing ones better. So again, it's that coming back to that point about an early engagement. And I think we also have to remember that we operate in a competitive system. You know, the attention of politicians, especially, but civil servants, officials, you know, the people actually sort of doing the hard work, if you like, of the policy development, have lots of different organisations and individuals that try to come to them with their ideas, you know, for new, you know, for new legislation, you know, or new regulations, you know, as well as changings to existing ones. So, you know, we've got to make sure that what we are doing is grabbing the attention of a reasonably limited number of people, so much more effectively. So again, we're back to this point about, you know, good engagement and what does good engagement look like. And that's about knowing and understanding the motivations of the people that you're trying to engage with. And I think that's, you know, in that sense, you know, it's a communications point. So a lot of what we do is actually about communications and good communications, sort of, you know, mapping out how a policy is developed. Maybe this is straying into one of the other P's there about process, but looking at how policies develop and how we engage. It just so happens that a lot of the time that we deal with a political audience, and that political audience, that political stakeholder group, is quite different from those that other parts of communications deal with. And it's different because they have to be elected. They have a different set of motivations about them than other stakeholders do. And what does that mean? It means that, you know, if you're an existing politician or government, you need to show that you've delivered over a period of time, however long, you know, and in, you know, certainly in our political system, the government sort of gets to make up when it goes to the polls, you know, and so we can have relatively short governments, we can have sort of, you know, slightly longer 5-year governments as well. But whatever whenever they go to the polls, whenever they go for a general election, they have to be able to stand up and say, look, this is what we have achieved over this time in office. Or for those looking to get into government, or those newly, you know, people looking to be newly elected into positions, they have to show what they will achieve. They have to show what they will deliver. So again, all of that thinking and that understanding of the audiences that we have to deal with is what we bring to the table. So I think those four, roundabout way of saying, those four P's are quite closely entwined, but I would go with policy because it helps us to think about that process that we need to be involved in over a longer period of time, and come back to that point. The earlier that we get involved, the earlier that you can have some input into that decision-making process, the better.
Thank you, Stuart. If I would answer this question to myself, I think the processes would be something which is not very much known also for those people who lobby. Because if you look at the profiles of people who work for associations, as independent lobbyists, or in agencies, or for various companies, usually they have some background. They came from public administration to few years in the civil service, assistance of members of parliament, or something like that. Some background of this kind. And usually the process of politics is very long and very complicated, and with years it becomes more complicated, because then there are some precedents, past events which influence the current situation, and usually these people know just part of the whole story. They know the parliamentary part. So for example, we receive sometimes some CVs from former politicians, or maybe they don't send CV, but they talk informally, but they know the very important part of the process, which most people think is the core of the lobbying, and in certain sense it is, the parliamentary side. But then there is the public administration before and after the implementation. So this is the long chain, and also if you count, I don't know, various stakeholders, regulatory institutions. So the whole process, and you are learning, we are learning it, everyone is learning the whole process as it goes, and so to understand where you stand in the process, that it's and you touched upon this, Stuart, that it's not if you start lobbying in the parliament, it's sometimes too late for big changes. You might do some small changes if there is a will, but the earlier you start, for example, you are not in the EU, but for us as a EU member state, and you will not debate it. You have to simply accept a lot of these things coming from Brussels. But we still have a word around the table in Brussels, and they are our civil servants who come to Brussels to negotiate something, which 2, 3, 4 years after become a law in all EU member states. And in that moment, that's usually the moment where the whole process starts. So for me, I think the process is something which should be better known, because it's not so obvious when speaking about lobbying as the political discourse or politics as such.
If you have something, I agree, I think you're right there, and I think that doesn't help with our own reputation, as you mentioned about the Czech Republic and certainly in the UK as well. Because people don't really understand what we do, it's partly because they don't really understand the political process. So, you know, we all end up with a sort of our reputation's tainted because of a lack of understanding about the system. Now, that's not necessarily our fault, but it certainly doesn't help.
Yeah, thank you. Just technical remark, you have the...
Sorry, Vaclav, I think you've just muted.
Sorry. You can use the Slido app to put your questions, or put it here in the chat, or then feel free to raise your hand, and I will whenever you want, and I will then try to make you speak. So going back to our conversation, I have one. I want to also touch upon the topic of ethics and transparency and rules. Here in the Czech Republic, currently there is another attempt to pass the law regulating lobbying. It's in the parliament now debated. It will be very soon. I will probably not go into details, but there are definitely some better norms of how to do it than the one which is now in the pipeline. I recently, or a few years ago, I read the book of personality you definitely know, and a lot of our, participants know, Ian Greer, who was famous and sometimes infamous British lobbyist from the 80s and 90s. He wrote the book One Man's World, which is like interesting from many reasons. But the reason which I picked out of this book is that he described the moments of interaction between lobbyists or business and British politicians or members of parliament in a way which is unimaginable now today. Like a company came to the member of parliament. He said, "You should go to this lobbyist. He's really good." Usually, it's the guy who wrote the book, Ian Greer, and then he sent an invoice for a referral of this service to the lobbying company, and it was perfectly legal in that time. And then there were some scandals, but I want to focus on the scandals, because the scandals are usually that what makes lobbyists be perceived in a very wrong light in the public. And the scandals which we know, for example, there was this cash for questions, but in the UK, there was in the European Parliament, there was a scandal of fake lobbyist. It was a journalist of, I think, Daily Mail or I don't know what British tabloid was it, to offer politicians contracts. In the Czech Republic, we had similar scandal with the gambling lobby, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 years ago. But in none of these scandals, a lobbyist was involved. They pretend being lobbyists and try to corrupt the politicians. And those who failed, and we can see it on many other scandals we know from recent history, were the politicians. And it's, of course, easier to regulate someone else, like to regulate lobbyists and not to regulate themselves. But for example, in the European Parliament and in the British Parliament, there were some rules introduced to prevent the conflict of interest and to declare incomes, et cetera, et cetera. But so maybe my question, this was a broader introduction, but I want to just draw it on attention that speaking about ethics of the behavior between politicians, lobbyists, politicians, journalists, politicians, I don't know, anyone else, is a, like two-way street. There should be both sides of it. We have some, self-regulatory measures here implemented, despite not having the law. You have the law on regulating the lobbying in the UK, I think since 2014 or 15. What do you think that it, I don't know, what do you think it brought to you? Do you think it did it help to the reputation that you have the regulation, or it's not intertwined?
No, I think the legislation that we've got currently, I mean, I think you could probably technically describe it as rubbish. It didn't do what it was meant to do. So you're entirely right. If we go back to the 80s and into the 90s, we had a situation where that sort of link between lobbyists and politicians, businesses existed. Money exchanged hands for activity in Parliament. We know that's the case because there were court cases around it. And there's some, one or two MPs' names, personalities that are still sticking around that, if you're in the UK, they've become slightly infamous because of that. And that's a situation that we sort of found ourselves in. So we had a self-regulatory system to try and overcome those problems. Pretty successful. I mean, people thought it could be a bit tougher, maybe it lacked the teeth, but it certainly tried to put some, to give everybody some good guidance and standards of behaviour. You then get to, more recently, so post 2010, David Cameron's government coming in, and there is a huge irony here, obviously, which we can come back to. But David Cameron says, the next big political scandal will be lobbying. Now, at the time, and I remember being asked about this on the BBC when I appeared on one of their programmes, what's he talking about? So I have literally no idea what he's talking about. I don't know. He's just made this comment. But what it enabled him to do was then bring in, as you say, some statutory regulation, laws around what we can and can't do. The trouble is that the laws that were passed pleased nobody. And they were very, very narrow in their scope. So in effect, me as a consultant lobbyist, as we're called, i.e. those people that go out there and, lobby for money, i.e. we have clients that come to us, we charge them and, so that's the only form of sort of lobbying, or the only form of lobbyist, I should say, that's covered. And the only form of lobbying that's, our actions that are covered are, if we have individual sort of contact with government ministers, and if we have interaction with the very, very senior, and only the very senior level of the civil service of officials, policy officials, that's it. So it doesn't cover Parliament. It doesn't cover individual members of Parliament or members of the House of Lords in our system. It doesn't cover in-house practitioners. So I know a lot of people on today's call, work for companies and organisations, so they wouldn't be covered because they're not a consultant lobbyist. So it's very, very limited in its scope. And we are still, you're right, you're testing my memory as to when the legislation was passed now, but, so we all adhere to it, but it's very limited. So the discussion really since then has been, when does it get extended? How does it get extended? And, and we're still in that discussion point now. So it's helped in the sense that there are now laws around, but they're so limited in their scope that frankly nobody's very happy with it. And it hasn't prevented the more recent, again, you're right, lobbying scandals with no lobbyists to be seen. And the ones that I mentioned, Boris Johnson and David Cameron, which are effectively about access. They're about having using your old networks, they're about knowing the right people and using that in some privileged way that frankly most businesses don't have, and ordinary people don't have. So you've got a system that's effectively built up against them. So certainly in terms of the way that I do my lobbying, of course we adhere to the law, of course, but I'm also a member of the the CIPR, the Chartered Institute of Public Relations. So I adhere to their codes of conduct. I'm involved with the PRCA as well. And they've got their own sort of codes of conduct as well. So they're, again, you know, very clear on what members of the PRCA can do. I also try and, I mean, you know, it's a bit, maybe a little, you know, day to day, but, you know, I do try and keep my CPD up to date. I do try and, you know, read books. So I'm very happy to have the recommendation of your new book back to come out, which I will devour in the English when it comes out later this year. To you know, to keep learning, to keep finding out what best practice is and see what others do as well. And I think my final point really is that, you know, because so for those, probably the vast majority, if not everybody on the call, BDB Pitmans, who I work for. So I head up the public affairs practice at BDB Pitmans. We are a public affairs consultancy, but we sit within the law firm. So BDB Pitmans are a law firm. And I'm sure this is a pretty universal truth. The regulatory systems around expectations around law firms is certainly a lot higher than it is for most other professions. So as a, you know, by working in a law firm, I also have to think about conflicts of interest. And I also have to think about, I mean, these are the two main ones, conflicts of interest, and also you know, where money for clients comes from, i.e., you know, money laundering, checks, and all those sorts of things. And that's because I sit within a law firm. So, you know, you could argue that I adhere to all those higher standards still. So that tends to be over and above what many others in the profession have to think about. So, you know, that gives me an extra layer of, I was going to say protection. I don't quite mean protection, but it gives me, it means that I have to think about more, even more, in that ethical standpoint. You know, and I think, you know, the sooner other professions, and I would include, you know, public affairs, lobbying as a profession as well, the sooner we all have to adhere to those sorts of standards, I think the better. I think that gives all the people that protection and reassurance that they will need as well.
Thank you. Maybe if I will just briefly mention, we have the code of conduct of the association, which is a prerequisite to be members of the Association of Public Affairs Consultancies. Those of us who are registered in Brussels are also have to adhere to the transparency register, which is its code of conduct. By the way, I think that's a very smart way how to not to call the register lobbying register, but call it transparency register, because transparency is what the main purpose of it's about. And for many, companies, this is also not. Maybe some companies don't like the word lobbying. We had some conversation with our clients that if you mention in our contract lobbying, don't use this word. Put there, I don't know, consultancy, public affairs, government affairs consultancy, but not lobbying. So there is still a fear about this. And we have one question we have more questions, but which concerned the transparency. There is a, I think the question one is about Germany, that whether we see, it's Annemarie Furtscheger, our former client, we see Germany introducing a lobbying register at the state level. Is this a move in the right direction, and what are downsides of such registers? And I will connect it with the other question on transparency, whether how far the transparency can go so it would not turn to be counterproductive. For instance, if industries and politics communicate via the media, is this really desirable? So when there is a limit, I mean, I would maybe translate it, and we have the discussion around the lobbying law, if there will be too many obligations for lobbyists, and there would be a way how to bypass them, for example, being a law firm, and just adhere to the law on bars, or to be, I don't know, to be consultant in something totally different, or you would not declare, you will find the holes where you can escape from the regulation. Where is the limit of the transparency? Maybe put it that way, where it would be counterproductive. Where is the moment where the registration and this obligation would become counterproductive?
Yeah, it's a very good point. I mean, I think the I'm not going to pretend to be an expert on the various registers that are already in place or are coming into place. I mean, obviously I'm most familiar with the Brussels one, Westminster, and there's one in Scotland as well. I mean, they all take, a slightly different view of these things. I suppose I've got two different perspectives on the amount of transparency, if you like. One is that you can go to the other extreme. Now, I suppose I'm less worried about that from a company perspective, although there would be, of course, costs involved in complying. But I'm almost, I suppose, more concerned about it from the sort of the user side of things, the recipient. So, who you make so much information available that it effectively there's just too much out there and you can't really see what's going on. So the amount of information that's made available has to be useful to somebody so that they can look through the register and say, well, look, this company has been engaging with these politicians in this way. And, they've got this size of team. Those sorts of issues would be useful. If you go too much information, then effectively there's just so much out there that it becomes pointless, really, I think, or that's the danger. But I think if you keep focused on engagement with direct engagement, I think is really the most useful side of things. So the direct engagement with political audiences or officials on a particular policy area, then I think that's sort of useful, doesn't take up huge amounts of time, but people would find, useful on the receiver end as well. So that wouldn't include, as you've suggested, media relations and things like that, because actually, if you're talking about media relations, sometimes, it's not always extremely obvious that you're actually trying to get to a political audience, a good story about, we talk about, vaccines and things like that at the moment, but, on those sorts of issues, aren't directly, about, exerting political pressure, if that's what we're thinking of lobbying as being. But by raising the profile and making the public more, engaged and aware, then could it have that implication? Yes, it could do, but that's not the necessary aim of that particular piece of work. So I think it's around that direct engagement around, politicians and policies, and then being clear on what we are and aren't allowed to do. But equally, again, I'll use politicians as the example, being clear on what they are and aren't allowed to do as well. It's that two-way street bit, which you've already mentioned back. I mean, it is around, us having requirements, but also the political audiences having, requirements, either through the parliament or the assembly, of which they're a member, or set down by governments. It can be either way, but that's a really, not particularly clear answer, because I'm not sure there is a direct answer, but I would put it more around the engagement. The more that we're focused on transparency around the engagement, I think we would all find that useful.
Yeah, when I wrote the book, I tried to, make it as I didn't focus on regulations specifically, because it was not my task, but I want to show to everyone that the portfolio of lobbyists and lobbying is so broad that you have CEO of a company who is doing his own job as a CEO, but from this very defending of the interest of the company, this in many cases means to lobby, basically to meet people to discuss. And so that's why I think that I'm not a big fan of like reporting everything, because then you would not if you build any regulation just on reporting, it's so difficult in the situation where you exchange WhatsApp messages and whatever. What is the communication? How do you define communication? Sending letters or meeting people face to face? But then one message can change the whole situation. So there should be some obligation put to policymakers. And some policymakers in many countries, including the Czech Republic, are themselves publishing whom they talk to. There is a huge space, at least here in the Czech Republic, which in the UK works, there's a huge space of improvement on public consultations, the UK, and we had the presentation for the chamber, how it works in the UK, how it works in Brussels, how it works in, I think, New Zealand or Australia is a very good example, how to involve as many lobbyists, as many interest groups as possible in the very early stage of drafting legislation, so they would not come in the mid of the legislative process panicking what's going on, so they can be told, okay, you had the chance to express already when it was drafted. So I think these are the transparency rules which should be implemented. But if in the situation when, especially in small countries, we are a mid-sized country, but in small countries like Slovenia, which is ranked by Transparency International as the most good, the best example of how the lobbying should be regulated, where everyone knows everyone. You just go to one coffee in Ljubljana and you met everyone, basically. It's basically impossible to, it doesn't make any sense to report meetings, because it's not about reporting meetings, it's about drafting legislation. And that's why I like the point of view of accountability, transparency, and just from the very very fact that you meet someone, it doesn't mean that he would follow your instructions, as many people think. You can see these two met, so it means that he's voting as this guy told him. No, it's most cases is not the case. So I will let's go to other questions we have here. I think I will leave Stuart to maybe to answer one which is very interesting. How can a balanced lobbying system be established? I mean, how can smaller interest groups of the society get the same power in politics as the private sector? And I will pick the next question on populism. How do you balance the small ones, the not so much financially strong interest with the big corporations?
Yeah, I think I've always got a couple of queries in my mind where it comes to these sorts of issues. First of all, I think you're right. There's a perception, and again, a lot of the time it's just perception, it's not reality, that bigger corporates have more money, therefore they spend more money on their politics, their political engagement, and their lobbying efforts. Now, frankly, that's just not always the case. When you speak to a lot of what you'd think of as big corporates, their government affairs teams, their lobbying teams are, a couple of people, not necessarily bigger than that. So I think that's the first point to bear in mind, is it's not always a, cash versus, lots of money versus not very much money sort of debate. Of course, there will be examples of that, but I don't think that's one that we should necessarily have to focus on solely. Even as a smaller organization, though, you need to sort of grab hold of what you're good at. Now, that might be around the groups that you represent. You are simply very good at engaging with a particular group in society that you're campaigning for or championing. And therefore, that's your really strong point in terms of your messaging that you give to these audiences. So in that sense, size doesn't matter, because what you're very good at is being very clear and very good in your engagement, but representing that particular group in society or that campaign. So they make the best of those strengths. The other side is that just because a company is spending lots of money on something, if that is the case, their engagement might not be any good. I mean, they might not be talking to the right people, for instance. They might not be saying the right sort of things, and bigger organizations often have to balance a whole number of different interests internally, not least, those, at the top of an organization that often have very clear views on how things should happen. They might not be very good for the engagement side of things. Whereas smaller organizations can be, quicker. They can make decisions more easily. And look, if you are bringing, evidence, if you are bringing new ideas, if you are bringing thought to that political process, regardless of where it is, you will be listened to. Because politicians, of course, will make the decisions at the end of it. So as you say, even if there is a sort of a one-to-one meeting, you know, we can put forward the best arguments there are, but the politician still has to make that decision around it, either through the official channels or if they're around voting. But, you know, they make the decisions. But what they really need, as I say, comes back to those motivations. They need to be re-elected or elected. And if they are going to make decisions, they need to be able to back that up in some way. They need to be able to show that they've been through a thought process, that there is some evidence there. You know, they're just not making this stuff up or listening to the last person they spoke to. They have to go, they have to be able to defend that. And again, that's a very good way for smaller organizations to focus their engagement and to work with those audiences. So I, the question is sometimes asked about, yes, it's not just sort of competing in that sense against the bigger organizations, but sort of why should we? And again, on that, I would sort of point to the fact that actually a lot of what governments do often have most ramifications, most impact on smaller and medium-sized organizations as well. Now, you might want to do your engagement directly, and for a lot of organizations, they can do that. That's fine, even if they are smaller. But for others, you will work through organizations. You will work through chambers of commerce. You will work through, other trade or representative bodies. So there are other ways that you can, you know, make your voice heard, even if it's not directly. But I would always say that, you know, that direct engagement, you know, should be there as well.
In brief, I sometimes tell people that there are emotions and there are money. And some big corporations are fighting something which is very emotional for a small group of activists, which resonates in media, where people have the, like, not only people, but also the politicians who read media and who try to feel the mood of the society, sometimes have the perception which is emotional about the topic. And you have to come with arguments, with something which would it's extremely difficult, despite the fact you might have a lot of money. You can pay, I don't know, advertisement, you can pay good lobbyists, you can organize on a conference or whatever. You still have to, you are not in equal position when it comes to emotionally strong topic on the other side. So it's not just about money and the size of the company. So one of the misconceptions about lobbying is looking at the US situation, where the lobbyists, unlike UK, unlike Czech Republic, unlike in any European countries, are basically part of the sponsoring or fundraising machine, helping political candidates to be reelected. Bear in mind that House of Representatives in the US, you have 2 years mandate. So basically you are elected and you start fundraising for the next elections. And in the US, there is nothing like state funded political parties. We have in many European countries, you become money for basically every seat in the parliament and or in the regional assembly. But in the US, there is nothing like that. You have to find money on among your supporters and among corporations and PACs and super PACs, etc. So this is very different situation, where the money really plays some leverage on, or are kind of leverage on politicians. But in Europe, of course, there are private money in politics, but usually these money are channeled to various people, and it's corruption. But in the US, this is the machine which keeps the political system working, moving. So speaking about emotions and also one of the topics we maybe not go too much details here, but it's these grassroots campaigns, which are very common in the US, where you basically mobilize a small group to be heard on a national level. It's something which we in Europe, there are some there are some small campaigns like this, but it's not fully artificial as it's often in the US. It's sometimes based on public demand. So let's go to the second question I wanted to pick, and it's about populism and lobbying. How much has the rise of populist politics impacted the world of lobbyists? I think it depends. Sometimes there is one aspect of it is the emotions. Populists bring emotions to the politics. So populists basically make their message on populism or on message which they know the people want to hear. And if you are able to stick to that with your interest, if you are basically, if you have the same interest as the populist party, it's an easy win. But if you go against, then it's not. So I think that it makes the landscape little less, organized or a little difficult to understand. In many cases, the other side of the populist and lobbying in the politics, and we see it here in the Czech Republic and in many countries, is that for many populist parties, or the parties, I would not say maybe populist, but parties with no ideology, that you don't know whether this person is socialist, conservative, liberal, green, or whatever, these people are usually technocrats. So for lobbyists, I would say, frankly, that it's easier to lobby them because they come from business environment. They don't have this ideological lenses or ideological glasses to see on things. And they are, if the problem you are talking about is not one of the major priorities of the government, it's something technical or not so important for the government as such, it's relatively easy to speak to them because you have to bring arguments, but the discussion is very pragmatic with those who serve, for example, as MPs of various non-ideological parties. I would not say populist parties, but non-ideological parties. That's my experience. What do you think, Stuart?
Yeah, no, I think that they are extremely valid points. I think arguably, you know, we've got quite a populist based, prime minister here, government at the moment, following on the coattails of Brexit. But lots of their other sort of policies seem to take reasonably populist positions. They have to decide as a government how to adopt those populist positions. So I suppose what I'm trying to say is you might find, I haven't really seen this yet, but it might be something that, you know, we all have to think about, is actually making sure there's a very high public profile for the issue that you're dealing with, to make sure that, you know, as a populist, they are absolutely listening to what's being said on the main media, the main, you know, as we have it, tabloid newspapers, or, you know, wherever, whatever they think is, you know, where the man and woman of the people, the real sort of, working class, often the real drivers, the real majority of the population are, what's their thinking. Now, they'll do that through focus groups, but they'll often take the temperature through the media as well. So it might be that as lobbyists, we do end up doing more across the media and social media to ratchet up the profile of an issue, to show there's some real momentum behind a particular cause or a particular position that populist politician might well then take notice of. So I haven't seen loads of that sort of as yet, but one can well imagine that being a consequence of more populist styles of government, I think.
Yeah, you are right. And I will maybe come to the next question before we have one more question, which I will leave to the end, how to become a lobbyist. So that will be our maybe a later question. But now I will come to one which touched also the British, and you mentioned it, so British politics. And it also shows one of the weakest points of, one of the misperceptions when speaking about politicians. And this scandal of David Cameron give to many people a proof that it works like they think it works, and not like we are with Stuart. We are telling them it works. And you wrote a blog on the PRCA website, which I have to quote one sentence, that Mr. Cameron's effort have thrown a spotlight on links between politicians, their former colleagues, and civil service. By the way, it was for those who are not well informed about this scandal. David Cameron, during the pandemic crisis last year, made some phone calls and participated in a conversation with Bank of England on behalf of investment fund, which just recently got bankrupt, and all these scandal became public. And he used his, contacts and his reputation to help the fund to be included in a relief measures of the British government. So, and what Stuart said about it, that they have only reinforced many people's misconceived ideas of lobbying and public affairs. Is it often seen as being about backroom deals or worse, about money? My question to you is, what to do with that? How can we fight this? That when the former prime minister is proving us not wrong, but
well, I mean, he's taken us back to the 80s, hasn't he? He's taken us back to the 1980s, and he has the irony that I mentioned earlier on. He has created the next big scandal, which is lobbying. So the man that said the next big lobbying scandal was lobbying has created it himself. It does take us back to that point about behavior in the 80s and the 90s. I mean, you know, and we as a, I suppose just taking one step, I'm happy to call myself a lobbyist. I don't mind being called a lobbyist, but I tend to think of myself as a, and I would normally badge myself as a public affairs practitioner. The reason that I do that is, one, because I think public affairs is broader. So it's not just about the parliamentary side or, assembly side with MPs and members of the House of Lords for us, but obviously, for different systems, but that direct political engagement. As a lobbyist, effectively I was focused on parliament and politics. I think as a public affairs person, I'm thinking about other stakeholder groups. I'm thinking about the media sometimes. I'm thinking increasingly about social media. I'm thinking about all the different tools and channels that we would use, again, to exert influence. And I don't think any of us should shy away from its influence. We are, as public affairs or lobbyists or government affairs or whatever we want to call ourselves, we are trying to influence government, public policy. But that's the same for any organization. So again, we don't get fixated on it about being money and business and things like that. Anybody engaging in the political process is seeking influence. But if you say that you are a lobbyist, I mean, if I go to a barbecue or something like that at the weekends and somebody says, what do you do? And I say, if I were to say that I'm a lobbyist, they would still think, even though the stuff from the 1980s and the 90s is now a very long time ago, and certainly well before I was doing this job, which is now a long time, but not quite that long. You will get the reaction of, it's all about brown envelopes full of cash. That is what people think lobbying is about. It's about making money work the political system. So, the Cameron example reinforces that idea about a sort of a cozy club of people that know each other, that went to school or university together, looking after each other and making decisions for themselves, not the country as a whole. And certainly from the UK, and I know this may resonate with other countries as well, that also plays into prejudices about, class and privilege as well. So that all sort of gets, sort of slightly mixed up with, this is slightly bigger, bigger sociological type issue for the UK, but it does all sort of get sort of mixed up in that. So there have been, and I double checked this morning just to make sure that I was right. So in post-Second World War, there have been 15 prime ministers in the UK. Only four of those didn't go to Oxford University. That's it. So basically, if you want to be Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, you have to have been to Oxford, to all intents and purposes. Now, that sort of says something itself. And actually, it's not quite as big a number, but most of those Prime Ministers also went to fee-paying schools. So public or private schools, depending on where you are, but their parents or whatever paid for them for their primary and secondary education, and then they went to Oxford. Not quite as many for the paying education, but a large element as well. So again, you've sort of got this idea of a cozy club of people all doing favors for the other way. So I think the only way through this is transparency. I mean, I think it's that, again, it comes back to that point that we made right at the start. You know, you put the transparency in there, you put the you know, the sunlight being the best disinfectant. I think that's the way we do it. And we apply it to the politicians, you know, and we apply it to the lobbyists as well. And those lobbyists are also not just businesses. They are also NGOs. They are also charities. So it's all of us. We all have to adhere to that same level of transparency. Then we will overcome, I think, the problems that the likes of David Cameron has placed on us.
We have one follow-up question on this in chat. I will try to, from Jan Waldinger, should one fault Cameron for trying or fault those who agreed to give preferences which they might not otherwise have given to anyone else? So whether his fault for trying or fault those, you can see it in the chat. Do you see it, Stuart?
Yeah, sorry, I'm just doing a double check. I think you can blame David Cameron. I think you can. You know, he is a former prime minister. He should be acutely aware of how his actions will be perceived. I think, you know, the fact that he didn't go through, you know, the proper channels and he tried to get around those by using mobile numbers that he had because he had been the prime minister, I think absolutely, you know, he should have been acutely aware of his position. He should have been aware of the danger of his own reputation, but the reputation of his former colleagues as well. You know, and he's the one that put the legislation in the first place. So I know, you know, again, strictly speaking, the legislation doesn't cover him and his activities, because he was an in-house lobbyist, not a, you know, a consultant lobbyist. So that's a failing of the legislation, which I mentioned earlier. Again, you can say, well, if you're the company, you employ people like Cameron because you know that he's got the phone numbers, the mobile phone numbers of these people. Well, again, you know, you say the company has gone bankrupt, so it's slightly different. But, you know, if you want to, well, put it this way, I would always apply that tabloid test. I would always apply that front page newspaper type test. If you are a company or any organization, but if you are a company and you're paying a politician, former politician, whatever, to do certain types of jobs, they behave in a certain type of way. Are you happy for everybody to know about that? If it appeared on the front page of the newspaper. If the answer to that is no, well, don't do it. If the answer to that is yes, well, you deserve everything you get in terms of regulations and legislation that will come your way afterwards. Your decision. I know where I am on that scale. It's up to other organizations to make their own judgments.
I like this front page test. We can see it on our front. We have shorter tradition of democratically elected prime ministers, but there were many of them after 1989. And I would say the only one stand this, the only one from those who end up in business would stand this test. And usually they are valuable for some companies, and we can see it on former German Chancellor Schröder. They are valuable for foreign, I mean, not European companies who want to have someone who would open the door for them, because this is the way how it operates in Asia or in Russia. But it's not sustainable for a long time. Usually, this is these people are there for you, some of them end their political career with some kind of scandal. So for many Western companies, they are not acceptable. and those who either step down or basically lose elections or whatever, they have to be clever enough to do the work as you describe it, to be maybe not fully transparent, but to behave properly, and to use not only the knowledge of phone numbers, which is in the current situation is not something which is so special about former prime ministers, but it's also about knowing the processes and knowing where to intervene in what moment of the political process. And I will say my personal maybe experience from 12 years or 11 years ago when I started the working for CEC, and CEC was the brand here for, I don't know, 15 years before I started working with CEC. But I came from non-governmental sector. I was former assistant to MP, which was definitely not a high profile position, but I learned the process, at least in that time, how the parliament works and how the office of the prime minister works in that time. And the only thing I had in that moment was the brand and my clients. So we have been working for many big international corporations. And it's not the problem of access. You can access basically anyone here. Czech case is special that you can text with prime minister very easily, but you should have the content. It's not about getting phone number, but it's about having something to say. You can do it once, you can do it twice without any content, and then the communication basically stops because these people have nothing to, if you don't have anything to bring them, then they don't have any further incentive to meet you again. So you have to have a content. And my personal experience, I had a brand, I have the brands of our clients, and I didn't know the people I started to meet 11 years ago, the prime ministers, the ministers, regulatory authorities, but I had something to bring to their table, which was worth to discuss.
Yeah, sure. And I think the question that's just come through there as well about, you know, Cameron and what he could have done differently to make his lobbying more acceptable. I mean, there are two things that I would point to, particularly in his instances. One is don't text people. He seemed to do all his lobbying via text. And it's all, you know, relatively short form as well. So that would be one thing. Don't text people, and he was borderline stalking them as well. You know, so he was, if he didn't get an answer straight away, he'd be, you know, there'd be two or three more texts. So that'd be one thing. Second thing through is understand the level. And again, you know, for any client, this would be the case. You don't engage directly with ministers. You go to the relevant official first and you work your way up if that's what's required, because most issues aren't, you know, they are often not very political. They're often about, again, it's maybe one of the P's, but it's about the process. And if you just go straight to the politician, actually you've misunderstood the process, and that sort of sets you back. You're entirely right about the arguments and the quality, the content of what you're trying to say. If that's not there, then they're not gonna do it. So it's about the right level, it's about the content, and not using text. I think that was what I would advise David Cameron. So if you were to come on my PRCA public affairs diploma, which I run, I'd say, look, Dave, that you've got plenty to learn.
So you answered the question of the follow-up question we had in the chat. Sorry. What he could have been doing more to make it acceptable. I will give a floor to anyone who wants to raise hand and speak live on this webinar. It should not be only among ourselves. If there are questions from the audience, I have some in the pipeline which might be raised, but feel free to ask. Just signalize that you want to step in. Ah, Mr. Kondash. So I hope, can you, Pavle, can you put him on, can you put him live?
Yes, I will do so.
Yeah, we see, you should unmute your microphone and we can hear you. Mr. Kondash, you are on mute, I see. The phrase of the year 2020, you're on mute. We don't hear anything. So
just a second. Okay, it should work now.
Yeah, now
it is working. Okay, excellent. Good. So hi, gents. Actually, I'm Jan from Tesco in the Czech Republic. Václav, thank you very much for writing or compiling the book. I read it with a huge interest, so it's been, I think this is a very useful publication. And nevertheless, of course, I also actually appreciate very much all the discussions with Stuart and with you. My question is the following. Václav, you know very well that in the Czech Republic we don't have a legislation for lobbying, and this maybe actually comes from the history of the country. We are seeing actually a lot of tensions between behavior of the politicians and also actually the perception of the publics. Stuart, would you advise us actually to go on the path of the investigating of the possible legislation in the Czech Republic and how we can go forward actually with this issue? Where this task?
That's a very good question. I mean, I suppose instinctively, I always worry, maybe this is borne out in some of the work that I've done over the years, but I always instinctively worry that as soon as politicians try and write new regulation, new legislation, there's a danger they get it wrong. Now, that means that we need to be good at our job and help our clients sort of engage in that process, but they can still get things wrong, or there's the sort of the law of unintended consequences that, you know, what they try and do is, you know, on the one level fantastically useful, but actually then just captures a whole range of different activities that they didn't really mean to capture. So that makes me slightly skeptical about sort of putting government too much in charge of these things. So I suppose in the first instance, I would say, look, you know, a good, well-policed, self-regulatory system with teeth, where if people are don't follow the codes, they are kicked out, named and shamed, you know, those sorts of things. So, you know, there's some proper action taken against them. I would always start with there. Now, for most countries, actually, most of us have got those sorts of things already in place. Therefore, if we then need to go to the sort of the actual, you know, statutory law regulation, then yes. But I think as much as possible, we try and not have to carry the huge amounts of costs which can often be involved. So when government set up new regulators, which we often sort of have to deal with, they don't make it some mass monstrosity of an organization that, you know, has loads of people working for it, that then the costs simply get passed on to the regulated, i.e. us, in some way. So that's the first danger. And I think the other danger is making sure that you have some way of making sure that it doesn't have any regulatory creep around it, that over the period of time, it sort of grows and grows and grows because it can, because that's often what, you know, regulators often end up doing. So, that probably doesn't answer your question, and I would think. But so I would start with the self-regulatory system. If we think we need government, you know, regulation, those sort of laws, then fine. But try and put some very clear markers in place to prevent some of the dangers that can happen. You know, say we ended up with a law that frankly isn't very good, really.
If my comment would be, it's following what Stuart said. It's extremely difficult to write it correctly, and we see a lot of publications of various NGOs who say, look, the UK has a law, Poland has a law, Hungary, I don't know, everyone has a lobbying law, so we should have it as well. But if you look in the details, Stuart spoke about the British example. We had here several years ago a Polish person who explained the Polish situation. They have a law which obliged something similar as the UK, but no one registered. No one is using it. But for on the paper, they tick the box. We have a lobbying law, and that's it. The other extreme is the law which would put a lot of administrative burdens to lobbyists. On the other hand, frankly speaking, if we would be the ones to bear this burden for many corporations, Western firms, they would pay more, frankly speaking, those who would submit themselves to the regulation, because it would be extremely difficult for them to declare everything, to do all this administrative stuff, which would be obliged. So then fees of the few like agencies or individual lobbies would rise, because it's basically classical example of a higher barrier of entry to a certain industry. So it has two sides.
Or what ends up happening is you use it as a glorified marketing opportunity. You know, the register that somebody fills in, and this can be, you know, voluntary as well as through law, you know, becomes a massive list of clients. You can say, well, look how well connected I am. I'm brilliant. Look at all these clients that I work for. You know, and does that achieve what we want? Not really. I mean, you know, might bring in some business, but it's not about bringing the transparency there that we really need. So again, you know, I suppose slightly be careful what we wish for under those sorts of circumstances.
Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions from the audience? Raise your hand. In the meantime, I will, please raise your hand. In the meantime, I will ask one question which is very much related to the COVID situation currently, which basically limited certain classical ways how to do lobbying, the meeting people face to face. You would rely, and you mentioned that digital tools, which are now being more and more present in public affairs, digital advocacy, various campaigns, etc. How did lobbying change the work of lobbyists in last 1 year? And do you think there will be something which will remain, or people will be thinking twice before meeting anyone without any clear reason?
Yeah, I mean, I think what's been clear is that how remarkably we've all coped, really. I mean, I think, you know, the business of government, wherever we are in the world, has still continued. Now, there has been an obvious focus and, you know, there's no getting away from that. But the fact that we've had the technology to do things like this, but also to conduct meetings with officials and with, you know, politicians, means that, you know, we can still have some interaction and have been able to, so we can still hold events and do the sort of usual business of public affairs and lobbying, if you like. I think that, you know, most of what we do is still focused around relationships. My instinct tells me that as soon as we can go back to doing some meetings in person or events in parliaments and assemblies and, you know, those sort of things, I think as soon as that happens, people will be only too willing to go back to seeing people properly again, and probably having a glass of rubbish wine and a sandwich together, and, you know, mingle and chat and just do things like we used to do now. So I suppose once we've been through that initial reaction, you know, against online, we'll end up in some sort of situation between times, which is, you know, for a lot of meetings, we don't have to travel and we can do this. You know, but for a lot of other stuff, you know, we'll still need that one-to-one in-face interaction. And, you know, politicians in particular like seeing people, like getting a feel for what you're saying, putting you on the spot properly, without knowing that, you know, you might be able to sort of reach down and get some notes or something along those lines. Actually, I'm seeing you, I'm going to put you on the spot, I'm going to ask you a question about this issue that you've come to me to talk about, and let's see how you react to that. So I think, you know, I think we will go back to that, but we'll end up in, as with most, you know, organizations, we'll end up in some sort of hybrid. And actually, you know, for politicians, I mean, you know, across the world, they haven't had to do the amount of traveling they do. So, you know, they've actually had some more time to do meetings. So if you've been able to, you know, really engage with them and grab their attention on a particular issue, there has been time to talk to them, because they don't have to get on trains or planes to get back to their, you know, the area that they represent, their constituency in the UK, for instance, to be able to do that. So it's not been all bad. You know, and I think there'll be more use of social media and all these sorts of things as well, but we'll end up hybrid. Everybody will end up hybrid, I think.
No, I must say that what's sometimes not very in public perception is not very well understood is that lobbying is not only about politicians. And politicians everywhere in the world are little old-fashioned guys who prefer to meet people because they were elected in the UK, it's very, very special that you have small, relatively small circumscriptions that you are elected in, but politicians are the ones who probably will go back to normal, I think. And they, from my experience here, they still want to meet in person. If the matter is really important, they want to meet in person. They probably will. It's easy for them to refuse a meeting because of the COVID, because when they don't want to meet. But for public servants and civil service, I think this situation probably will last longer, that the virtual meetings with stakeholders will be more common than it used to be before COVID, and I think these two will not have the same implications. And business wise, from my perspective, I think we had a very successful year last year, and one of the reasons for that is that we have some clients who were focused only on one specific area of policy. I don't know. Manufacturing policy, labor code, and whatever, like very small, which change every, I don't know, 2 years, nothing really like nothing. You have to be in a hurry. We send, I don't know, monitoring every month and then follow up call. And basically they lobby twice a year when something is going on. Last year, everyone started to follow what the government is doing when it comes to lockdowns, to border closures, various measures they have to implement in their, for example, in their facilities, to their employees, this child care substitution, school closures, and everything which we are following in the media impacted the businesses, supply chain across Europe, etc. So they now started to be more eager to know what is going on and also to lobby for their particular industry, why their industry is so crucial that should be part of critical infrastructure, for example, or some preferential treatment on the side of the state. And you have to find arguments, and you have to also give them a frank assessment whether it really makes them so special compared to, I don't know, nurses or first responders or whatever, that their industry have to be somehow preferentially treated. So all these things was part of the last year, and it was completely new situation when the state has such a big power, which was unprecedented in the recent history.
Yeah, and I think, you know, governments across the world will also now need to think, you know, beyond COVID. I know the vaccinations and the health situation, you know, varies hugely, excuse me, not just across Europe, but across the world. But as we start to see an end of COVID, at least in its worst form, hopefully, and most impactful form in terms of lockdowns, all governments are going to have to think about what that future country looks like. You know, what does a post-lockdown, post-COVID Britain look like? Does it have more devolution? So are powers pushed downwards? Is it about the economy? Is it about, you know, parts of the country, the north versus south for us, regional disparities? Is it challenging those? Is it focused more on skills? Is it focused on particular sectors? A whole range of different issues which government will have to think about. Whereas, whilst the impacts of COVID have been huge, but, you know, they've all been an emergency focus, which is, look, how do I keep the economy afloat? And how do I stop people dying? How do I keep the economy afloat? And how do I keep the health system working? You know, I mean, I know they're big issues, but, you know, those three things, it can now start to think beyond that. And certainly from, again, a particularly UK perspective, we have to remember that, you know, for the 18 months, 2 years before COVID, we had Brexit. So we've had a political system dominated by Brexit for 2 years. We had a new government, the first post Brexit, if you like, December 2019. By March 2020, COVID's hit. So we've only really had 3 months of a proper newly elected government under Boris Johnson that's been, positioned to do things that weren't Brexit or COVID. 3 months. It's not very long. And then the next election will be coming around in 2 years' time, roughly, depending on when they say it. So they've only got a short window. That, again, coming back to our understanding and of the process, but the motivations of politicians, which are different from other audiences, they've got to put themselves in a position where they can be re-elected in 2 years' time. So that means being good at mapping out what they're going to do in those remaining years and deliver something that's not just about COVID. So from our perspective as, you know, public affairs lobbyists, you know, frankly, that's an opportunity. It's an opportunity for all organisations to try and shape that post-COVID agenda and environment. So we, you know, we all have to be thinking about that.
Thank you. So, and if there is no other question, I will pose the last one from the chat. In the meantime, I put in a chat link on the lobbying show, which now is called the Political Life podcast. But you, as podcast, are usually in your podcast application, so you can find it. I don't know, Spotify, Google, Apple, and whatever. So I really recommend you to listen to some of the episodes. It's very US centric, but it gives you, I mean, very broader understanding of lobbying across US, and there are some also European episodes. So it's in the chat. And the last question, if no one is raising his or her hand, it's very easy how to become a lobbyist. It's the question from our Slido chat. What's your answer?
I came into it in a slightly different way. I mean, certainly in the UK, and I'm pretty sure this is a universal way into lobbying, is that people have usually worked in and around the parliament or the assembly. They worked for a member of the parliament, you know, in politics somewhere, gained some experience, maybe during, often, you know, during university or after university, after degree, and then they come into it at a junior position. Often do some sort of internship type arrangement, some training, and then they get kept on. I mean, that's certainly in the UK setting, that's a pretty traditional way in. I mean, I did it slightly differently. I did a PhD in politics at Aberdeen University, and then, did an internship for 3 months, and then, you know, had to prove that I could, you know, do the job, and then they kept me on. Fortunately, so slightly differently. So I was more about the study, and then into it, more about the practical application which working for an MP or a parliamentarian would deliver. I sort of mentor a few people and have done over the years that are sort of, you know, thinking about doing public affairs and lobbying. The thing that I always say to them is that, you know, increasingly, it's a very, very competitive profession to get into. So that means getting as much experience as you can, really. Now, whether that's, again, with a parliamentarian, whether that's with the local media, whether that's with a think tank, whether that's doing slightly different sort of research facilities, anything that improves or demonstrates and improves the skills that you need in the job that we do will count, is helpful, and will make your, you know, your CV, your application stand out more than, you know, it would over and above others. I'm going to sound like a very old person here, but, you know, when I think back when I did my degree, I had the PhD at the end of it. I didn't really have anything else. I mean, I watched a lot of television and went out quite a lot. I mean, I didn't, you know, kill myself in terms of, you know, my, you know, extracurricular activities that were on my CV. I nowadays, would I get anywhere? I'm not sure I would. The PhD might help me get through the door, but certainly without that wider knowledge and experience, I think people will struggle. So that's the bit that I always tend to push people towards, is to thinking about that. And you can do that in different ways. You can, you know, you can blog, you can, you know, get involved in different platforms that, you know, might take some thought leadership pieces from you, but, you know, make sure that your LinkedIn profile looks good as well, because increasingly employers, you know, across the globe look at LinkedIn profiles as a way of demonstrating your connections, you know, in a business sense, not a sleazy political way, but your connections and your experience. So I would point to those sorts of things in the modern setting. You've got to just make yourself stand out and show people that you know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I would be a little skeptical. I fully agree with what Stuart said. I would be really skeptical towards various university courses that you study public affairs. I teach also one course on Faculty of Social Sciences, but it's more extracurricular, and I think it's useful for students that they understand early enough, the communication professionals, for example, understand early enough what the lobbying is about, but I would not recommend to, I mean, have a full-fledged master degree in public affairs, because it's very theoretical. Usually the lobbyist profile is, I see lobbying something between law or legal professionals and communication professionals, somewhere in the middle. So usually lobbyists have a background of political sciences, myself and Stuart, the lawyers, economists, journalists, let's say. These are the most common, but we have some Czech lobbyists who are by education, I know, chemical engineers, etc., which can happen. And usually they have some experience in politics, around politics, as assistants of MPs or in junior position in public administrations. If you go too higher, and I know some cases that some people were members of parliament in their, I don't know, 20s, and then they wanted to become lobbyists. Usually they were, they had this brand of the party they were elected for, and that was very unusual. Not everyone is Sebastian Kurz, and who became a minister in, I don't know, 28. So this is usual career, and I think this, you always have something you don't know, you have to learn. I before I came to lobbying, I worked for a think tank, I worked for as a advocacy democracy promotion activities, and as an assistant of MP. And when I started to become to work for in lobbying, I have zero contacts in business. So I have to build the contacts in business. On other way around, there are some people in business, usually in-house lobbyists, who know people in business, but they have little or no contacts on the other side of the, on the political or media or public side of their work. So you have to combine the two. There is no ideal candidate who knows both sides equally well. And from the, I mean, recruiting, not only for us, usually companies in those countries, the public affairs firms are relatively small. If you compare them with Big Four or with law firms, etc., they are much smaller, or they are small teams within, for example, communication agencies. But usually you want someone who has an experience with public service, 2, 3, 4 years, and then he started a junior position in lobbying and can rise. And this is the usual way how, and in Brussels probably it's maybe more structured. There are thousands of lobbyists or people working in public affairs, but those who you would call really lobbyists are the top of them. After 20 years in Brussels, you go from junior consultant to I don't know, researcher consultant, then you can really interact with commissioners and whatever. In smaller countries like ours, it's much easier. In small firm like ours who work for big international clients, it's easy for even for junior people to be present of a meeting with prime minister, which probably in the UK would be difficult or not so easy as this small country. But so feel free to explore. It's a small, I mean, the professional lobbyist is a relatively small industry, but there are people, for example, if you understand politics and you are, for example, in-house lawyer, you can get lobbying as an additional function within your company, because for many companies, the regulation is not the question of existence, but they are lawyers or external affairs specialists who add to their portfolio of on their list of duties, external relations, and then you can build on that. Not every company needs in-house lobbyist or in-house or external agency. You have to have something to deal with the state.
Okay. I'd also just add that, you know, just to keep your professional development going as well, do the training courses, read the books, and keep up on that, because I think that helps with our, you know, point about ethics and you know, being good at the job and people having, you know, confidence in what we're doing. But frankly, it just, you know, it's your point again about continuing to learn. You know, we all continue to learn all the time. And, you know, whatever level we're at, even for the more experienced, you know, people, there will always be things that they can learn. So, you know, there are, you know, courses available you know, not necessarily through universities, but through, you know, professional bodies, and, you know, so keep that up. I think that would be another way that certainly I try and, you know, maintain my professional development as well.
Thank you. And we are slightly over time. So thank you, Stuart, for being with us here to share the other part of the English Channel's perspective on this, on lobbying and public affairs. Thank you, Stuart. Thank you, Marcelo.
Pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
For hosting this event, and as you will soon be moving from the chamber to NGO, which is unusual direction for many of us, or back to NGOs. Wishing you, I think we will stay in touch, but good luck. And thanks to all our participants who survived with us. We are losing some, but those who remain are the ones who deserve to be thanked. Thank you. Thank you, Stuart. Thank you, Marcela. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Václav. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.